Game on. It's game on. We are big on sports. Big on sports.
Definitely a very good afternoon and a warm welcome to Game On. It's certainly Fun Friday, and if I were you, I would definitely brace myself, because for the next 1 hour, we've got a big conversation when it comes to the world of sports and definitely football specifically on the show today. We've got a whole bunch of guests that should be joining me, and I need to stick around because it's going to be a very exciting conversation. But for those watching back home, I do remember the English Premier League did return on Wednesday. Action returns later this evening. Norwich City up against Southampton at the Cow Road, and the crunch time will be down in North London as Tottenham do come up against Manchester United. Plus, there is elsewhere action in Germany. There's football in Spain. There's football happening in Italy as well, as the Italian Serie A officially gets underway. And on the show this afternoon, we've got the chairman of Mbarara City Football Club, the Ankole Lions, that is Honorable Mwine Mpaka. He'll be speaking to us extensively regarding the situation at the club coming from last season, but certainly quite importantly, they've held a couple of meetings from last week regarding some of the issues that they've got, especially from last season. That is something we shall be discussing on the show. But first things first, we are joined by a relatively young man like myself. His name is Douglas Smith, and he runs a company called Sportry, something that he'll be telling us about. Now, the unique thing about Douglas is that he's probably one of the few Ghanaians that have come up with an initiative of manufacturing soccer balls that is locally, and clearly he's taking the sports fraternity by storm. And he does get to join us for the first couple of minutes before we get to open up the conversation in there. Douglas, how are you doing? Welcome to Game On Fun Friday.
Oh, thank you. I'm great to be on the Fun Friday show.
And I understand it's not your first time on Game On. Quickly, I want you to say hello to all the viewers watching Urban TV out there.
Hello, viewers. I want to thank you all for watching Urban TV. My name is Douglas. I'm excited, really, to be on today's show. Yeah.
All right, first things first, Douglas, that ball you are holding in your hands, for the viewers out there, anyone that may not know, I need you to confirm to us that you are actually the person, the mind behind its production and manufacturing.
Yeah, like I said, my name is Douglas, and I'm the founder and CEO for Tri Uganda, a social enterprise company that has taken up the challenge in Uganda to start producing soccer balls locally in Uganda, Uganda. So this ball is locally made here in Uganda, Uganda, and as you can see, it has a logo for KCCA, our own club here in Uganda, and it also has our company logo, Portray, and also my personal brand, D-Smith.
And the challenge, Douglas, everyone is going to be wondering, how good are those balls? Can I use it to have a competitive game? Talk to us about the quality, and if anything, how do you even come up with the idea in the first place?
Well, I can say the quality is going to be good. This is a prototype, and I want to assure you that the quality is really going to be very good for all our clubs or for everyone that wants to buy this ball. How did I come up with this idea? I drew the inspiration from my passion for sport. I personally have a foundation, the Smith Soccer Foundation, that I use to bring a positive impact in communities, especially here in Uganda, to empower disadvantaged children through the power of football. So I've had very many challenges, especially in getting equipment, such as balls. Most of the balls that we have always had them from outside countries as donations. Some of them we have always bought them. So we have had a big challenge in buying these balls. One, they're expensive. Two, it's very difficult to import balls from outside the country. So when I made research and consultations, I found that we didn't have any companies in Uganda that are producing balls. And that was quite a big challenge. You understand?
Yes.
So, yeah. So I had to think very fast outside the box and find a way how I can produce a ball in Uganda. And here I am.
Quickly, Douglas, what is the idea, what is the vision you have for the initiative that you've kicked off with? In about 5 years from now, What direction do you see yourself taking with this new campaign you've started?
Yeah, I see this brand becoming one of the biggest brands.
Douglas, are you still with us?
Yes, I'm with you.
Douglas?
Yeah, I'm with you.
Okay, what's the journey you're taking with the new initiative you started?
Yeah, this is going to be a very tough journey. But I see this initiative, this brand Sportra is becoming East Africa's biggest brand, especially in producing balls and maybe in the near future also producing sportswear.
Okay, finally, as we get to go, two quick ones. One, have you tried to reach out to some of the different partners that could help you boost your capacity in terms of production? And then your final remarks to all the viewers watching Game On.
Yeah, sure. I'm trying to reach out to different companies so that we can do a partnership. I recently participated in the What's Next Challenge, and I became a lead winner.
Yeah.
And there are very many other companies that are trying to reach out to me so that we can do partnership. Probably,
okay.
Hopefully, everything comes out the best. And I want to promise the viewers that we are going to produce very quality balls, and we don't need to import balls again from outside countries.
Thank you so much, Douglas Smith, for joining us, and I want to wish you the very best going forward. And quickly, I want to pick it up with Honorable Mwine Mpaka here. First of all, welcome to Game On Fun Friday.
Thank you.
And Douglas Smith, there, fantastic idea he's come up with.
I think it's brilliant. I didn't know we were making balls in Uganda, but I'm sure he needs support.
Yeah.
I didn't hear him talking about his capacity, but I think he needs support, and it depends on the quality. I'm sure even Fufa can come in, and if this ball is to the international standard, I'm sure if he approached Fufa, probably they could use it as a league ball.
Yes.
And it would build more confidence for his brand. But otherwise, I'm sure also the Minister of Sports should be able to help this young man meet the relevant people to help him in his capacity building.
Okay, thank you so much, Honorable. And welcome to the show. I'm sure it's your first time here.
It's my first time here.
I look forward to a fantastic conversation. Plenty of things we should be discussing.
I hope so.
Definitely. Sharon Adong, welcome back to the show as well. How are you doing?
I'm doing very fine. I'm also looking forward to hosting you one day on Sportswoman.
You guys had a fantastic show yesterday. I saw you grilling Dr. Maggie Chigozi.
No. You know, when you have a person like Dr. Maggie Chigozi on your side, an entrepreneur, a doctor by profession, a mother. I mean, she's contributed a lot to sports in Uganda, once in two motocross, and then also played lawn tennis. So it was all a lot of mixed-up conversations with her. And as young women, we want to have women like her alongside, because when we talk about women in sports, we think we don't have old women who actually played sports, and yet they are there. So it's time now we need to bring them back and try telling us stories and giving us. So I don't know when we are hosting you, but I'm looking forward to having you on the Sportswoman.
I look forward to being there as well. Honorable Mwine Mpaka, first things first. We saw the other week, you, Honorable Bernard Atiku, led a team of a couple of chairpersons from a couple of clubs in the Uganda Premier League. And you had, a petition while you were trying to meet the Minister of Education and Sports, raise some of the issues that you had regarding how the season last season was concluded, the financial standpoint of some of the clubs. Ultimately, you also stayed away from the first consultative meeting that FUFA held on the 10th of this month before bouncing back for the big meeting yesterday. Walk us through that journey and some of the key things that you and the whole team have actually been raising.
Well, it's true we had issues. Originally, we were 10 clubs, and we were joined by a few more clubs, making it about 12. But we raised several concerns in our letter to the First Lady. Basically, we were seeking for intervention, because there was a very large communication gap between the clubs and FUFA. So we wanted her to mediate. It was kind of a mediation, because we know government cannot interfere in issues to do with the Football Federation. Otherwise, we can be banned, actually. But we wanted someone in a higher office to mediate, to try and build the relationship. Some people thought it was a war. No, it was not a war. We are just trying to look for a solution to mend the relationship between the clubs and FUFA. And yesterday, we had the first meeting where we attended largely, in large numbers. And we expressed some of our concerns.
Yeah.
But at least it was the beginning of a conversation we have not had in a very long time. And the FUFA president, together with the FUFA executive committee and the UPL board, agreed to have continuous meetings. So probably this gap we have been having is going to be bridged.
The question would be, what are those issues? Because you mentioned a couple of concerns you've got. And we need a breakdown. What are some of those things you feel like FUFA have actually not been able to address?
The key issue, of course, we asked for relief. We know clubs have been affected. Some of these clubs have sports betting companies that are sponsoring them. And the companies have also been affected because they have been closed for some time. These companies are paying rent. They are paying staff. It's now over 4 months. And we actually don't know the future of sponsorship. It's not only sports betting companies, but also private companies that are like Hima Cement and the rest. But we wanted relief. But most important of all, the reforms which FUFA had proposed. Most members were not pleased or were not amused by the speed at which these reforms were being brought. And we have seen in the past, some of the things FUFA used to impose on us, they used to do it without consulting us. So the fear of the unknown made the tortoise move with its whole house. So we thought actually this is going to be the same way they are going to treat us. They are going to just impose these reforms. But amongst which we think these reforms cannot work at the moment. One, they are proposing to have 28 clubs. That is 12 in the UPL, which means they're going to relegate six.
Yes, at the end of next season.
At the end of next season. So we are going to have 12 and the other 16 in the big league. We have been receiving sponsorship from StarTimes. This is about 70 million per Uganda Premier League club. It's about 8 million per month if you calculate the season. Now, if you divide this money amongst the 28 clubs, it means each club is going to get 3 million shillings, almost, on a conservative estimation, per month. And I don't see why I should go to the Premier League if a big league team is getting the same money as I'm going to get. Then the issue of relegating the 12 clubs, we asked FUFA, what are you trying to cure? Because we don't see you trying to cure anything. Even if you relegate six clubs, the problems these clubs have been having are going to remain the same. You have also imposed a junior team on a big league side. Even as Premier League clubs at times have issues with these junior teams, we are forced to outsource. We give them to schools because we can't manage. So we wanted to understand why is FUFA bringing these reforms and what is it going to help us?
Quickly, before we come back to you, Mwine, Sharon, he raises a couple of pertinent issues. I like the conversation of a breakdown in terms of sponsorship money at the junior team. We've seen the under 17 league being quite the success, but also, quite importantly, engaging these clubs from time to time. You know, how well do you think FUFA are doing in some of these aspects?
I think the first of it is that we must say kudos for the first time for FUFA to allow or to accept to sit down with a gentleman and one lady, or the two ladies, to have a meeting with them or discuss with them. This should have been an initial thing. It should have been. It should have started from the first of its sort. Because for me, I think the way the federation is run, it's run from top. Top bottom up, top bottom approach. It should have been bottom top approach. That is ideal if you're doing administration for those people who have really studied administration and management. Get involved people at the bottom, then bring up and say this is what we want to do. But where we've reached a point where someone thinks he or she can just wake up and impose something. Now, the issue of the junior league, I was quite very pertinent when they discussed about it. However, I don't know. Honorable is going to clarify for us here. We know very well that FIFA funds, has FIFA grants basically to fund federations that have the junior teams, the junior leagues going on, of course, including women football. So, and I remember we ran a story in the New Vision here, how clubs are suffering running the senior team and the junior team, and yet it's at the expense of the clubs, and yet FIFA gives out this money, and the money is misappropriated. So I don't know whether the chairpersons really address some of these issues in their meeting. That is where I want Honorable to come in a little bit. However, on the other point of downsizing the league, or downsizing the UPL to 12 teams, for me, I think it's totally crap. I'm sorry, it's totally crap because it's the same way, like you said, I don't see us solving a problem. We're actually causing more problems. When you want to solve a problem, if a tree is rotten, you do not go and cut the leaves. You have to start from the roots.
Okay.
That's where the problem is. We need to go back there and address the challenges. Why are the community teams struggling, first of all? Then you go to the institutional teams that are not performing so well. Look at Police FC. You expect police to be so good. Look at Maroons has also struggled until it went into relegation. So we need to do an analysis, a SWOT analysis, and see where we have failed so that we come out with a solution. Otherwise, relegating, even if you relegate all the teams that remain with the Express, Vipers, and KCCA probably, still the problem will remain the same. You do not solve any problem.
On top of the reforms and some of the queries she's raising, the financial aspect, because you yourself as well, you know, together with the whole team, came out and said we need a bailout, at least for 3 months, coming through from FUFA. They are the mother body, and they should be in a position where they can come and help the clubs, meeting some of their expenses, some of their costs, especially during the times of the pandemic. Do you think FUFA actually should have handled this situation better during the COVID-19 circumstances?
I think out of courtesy, FUFA should have tried to help these clubs. Because we have seen them supporting the national team, Uganda Cranes. But we, the clubs, we are the people who invest in the talent of these young people, even before they leave this country. We invest money in these young people. But you can see, for example, they are now investing in FUFA Drum. And they are using our players in the Uganda Premier League.
Right.
So why don't you give this money to the Uganda Premier League teams? And they still, because we thought the Drum would help us discover young talent. But like the Masaza is doing. But you're actually still using our players. These players are getting injuries. So why not give us this money? And you field our teams in another tournament, or another trophy. Well, but FUFA has its strategic plan, only that I may not agree with them on some issues. But we wanted FUFA out of courtesy. An example is the government. It's not the government's role to feed Ugandans. But when this pandemic came and people in cities were hit, the government purchased food for Ugandans.
As the father of the home.
Yes, so we expected FUFA. We were not forcing them out of obligation, but we thought out of courtesy they would recognize the work the clubs are doing for this country.
Okay.
The work, because we have so many challenges, but in this pandemic, they canceled the league.
Yeah.
Before it had come to an end. Yes, maybe they are discussed. But even yesterday we discussed this issue. Some of these decisions have financial implications. Star Times may not give us the balance of the sponsorship because the league was cancelled. So we expected, okay, maybe by law, out of the statutes, if you read the statutes, they may not need to consult us. At least consult the sponsor. Because these decisions are going to have financial implications on all the clubs, all the 16 clubs.
Okay, but here's something interesting. Engineer Moses Magogo says appropriation of the fund is done by an act of parliament. Ultimately, they cannot rechannel this money, you know, towards the clubs, because at the end of the day, they'll have to account for it. They'll be audited by the Ministry of Planning, Finance Planning and Economic Development. And that is something you've probably responded to. But also, in the same breath, aren't us to have a discussion regarding the way forward, you know, where do we go from here as Ugandan football? Because clearly we can't keep going back and forth with some of the challenges. How do we have a progressive approach?
Well, issues to do with financing of football clubs, it may not come now, but we have seen countries like Rwanda helping their teams and other countries. It may not come now. But the main issue to handle now is infrastructure development. We know there's a budget of $10 billion given to FUFA every financial year. This financial year, they got about $7 billion. They didn't get the complete amount because the last quarter, most ministries had budget cuts. But since we have members of parliament who are passionate about sports and some who are actually involved in these clubs, Sewanyana, Honorable Atiku Bernard, we had Nsereko, who had one and unfortunately left, we can move a motion and start a debate. At least some of this money should be diverted to infrastructure development right now. Much as we have already appropriated, we can still have the discussion in Parliament.
Okay.
Yes.
Sharon, some interesting issues there being raised, because at the end of the day, it's about growing the game of football, taking it from where it is and getting it to the next level. You think for FUFA, as the body mandated to grow the game of football, they should certainly be taking some of these things quite seriously?
Well, I think it's an issue that we've been discussing so much over way, over in, out, and we're still discussing about it, that FUFA needs to take some of these things so serious. Now, like for an issue is discussed, is hinted on the issue of budgeting. I think also, me, I would blame the commission who is in charge of sports at the Ministry of Education. Before they pass that budget of allocating the 10 billion shillings to FUFA, which they say is strictly for the national teams, they should have also first sat down that, okay, fine. Now we are going to finance the national teams. Now, how about the clubs? Where are these players come from? How are these people benefiting? How are you nurturing a player right from Barra City, from Vida, from Vipers, up to the time where this player is either playing for Uganda Cranes or is also going for professional football outside? Like today you're seeing Farouk Mia is out there. He started from here, from Vipers. So these are some of the stories that I think the Honorable Member of Parliament has hinted on could be something that they should build in, which I know is not going to be something easy. But of course, now you know we are going into general elections. This could be a point that you'll be bringing into discussion maybe in the next parliament. That is, we pray hard that people like him go through and they go back to parliament. Now, another challenge that we've been having is that, you know, when you have people who do not understand a certain thing, how it's done, like sports, we've been having so many legislatures in parliament who don't understand how sports is done. So a federation just goes with a budget and say, okay, boom, Uganda is going to represent us at AFCON, and that is it, and you're not bothered. Now, we also need to go back to the people we have who are representing us. We need to re-echo our voices as sports entities and sports fraternity. How many members of parliament do you need, for instance, to have in the house who can understand the game? Otherwise, you are still going to see these problems coming up because most of these people are compromising for their selfish interests in the name of saying they are promoting sports, and you don't see actually sports growing. Because, Brian, ideally, I am telling you, there's nothing much the national team does apart from only training these players for only 1 month or 2 weeks. But the rest of the training is done in the club. The players have to eat. I have managed football myself, so I know what it means. So, Honorable was quite very spot on.
All right, Honorable, before you come to Mbarara City, the kind of campaign, you know, the football club did have, someone was asking, why can't you as the leaders, you know, as the UPL clubs, have an association that brings you all together, ultimately have a more unified voice, probably make a better, you know, conversation for yourselves at the top? Because you've seen the referees doing this, a couple of different stakeholders in the game have actually been able to come up with this. Why isn't it happening for some of you as the chairperson?
Well, originally we have a third vice president who is supposed to represent the interests of these clubs, who is voted by these Premier League clubs, who is none other than Honorable Minister Nachuala. And this should be our voice.
Who doesn't happen to be a chairperson of a club anymore?
Yes, but it doesn't matter. We have looked at the statutes. She can still retain that position, whether she's a chairperson or not right now. But she's supposed to be our voice. She's supposed to be our unifying factor. Unfortunately, we only meet her when FUFA calls meetings or the UPL. She has not called us as clubs to discuss our issues. We raised it in our meeting previously, and she claims we do not attend the FUFA meetings at times, but we want her as a person representing the clubs to get involved in our issues, to come closer to us. But we have also come up with another solution. We are going to have monthly meetings as club chairpersons, and we are going to have a rotational system of chairing these meetings and hosting these meetings. So the next meeting is next month, towards the end. And Police FC is going to host us. So we are going to build a relationship.
That's good.
And a platform where we can discuss our issues and come up with solutions.
All right, let's get into that short break now. We still are joined by Honorable Mwine Mpaka, who happens to be the chairperson of the club side. That is Mbarara City, the Ankoi Lions. When you come back after the break, though, we'll be talking to him about Mbarara City. They finished seventh last season, but definitely time and again, they had changes in terms of management. They've also had some outstanding players, including Brana Hewa, who was totally exceptional for my last season coming into the new campaign. Plus, he's been into that exit and a couple of top sides. And he come back and so much more. You're watching Game Money's Fan Friday. Plus, later on, the English Premier League is back. There's a crunch tire 10:15 later this evening down in North London. It's Tottenham for Jose Mourinho. His Spurs boys will be up against Manchester United. Promises to be quite the big game. So we'll get you a breakdown of all that and so much more as football takes center stage. But for now, into that short break, we'll be right back.
Game on. It's game on. We are big on sports. Big on sports.